Let's Talk Games. I'm Fatui, and we are here today, and it's the fifth episode. We just been through the first week of January, and we already have two great games came out this week, and of course some awesome updates for the PSN store and Xbox Live. So it's pretty good start for the year. As you may know, the two games that that have come out this week, the major titles are of course Darksiders and Bayonetta. I've already got both of them. I have only played one of them, and that's Darksiders. So I played the demo of Bayonetta a long time ago, but I haven't actually played the game yet, because I've been so busy with Darksiders. I think I'm gonna start up looking at some of them, some of the good updates that have been coming. I have the list here for the PlayStation Store, which is pretty much the only list I can find. I didn't see anything significant come to the Xbox Live Store. Of course, there's of course the Dark Void demo came out this week on Xbox Live and on PSN, and of course the new update for or the second update or add-on Borderlands came finally out for PlayStation Network, which was a week late because of Sony updates on Thursday and Fridays, depending on which time zone you're in. And the problem is with that, well, it was New Year's and everybody had the day off, so nothing happened on the PSN store. So a week late, but we got it. But anyways, what I'm gonna talk about now is gonna go through this list here. Of course, the demo of Dark Ward, I haven't tried it out yet. Actually, the one thing I was looking forward to was the Mad Hazard Blood Beta and Beyond. So I downloaded the demo of that, or the trial. It's sadly a $15 game, and it's a 2D platformer, a 3D style, a little bit like Shadow Complex. And I already have the Return of Mad Hazard, which is a third-person shooter game. Really fun. I recommend it if you can get it on on any console, for instance, Xbox or PS3. Get it cheap, because it's not a great game. It has flaws, but it's really fun and entertaining, and easy to come by and go through. It's easy to pick up and play. Anyways, I had my hopes up because I had a lot of fun with the other game, so I hope that the 2D version would be fun. It's not. It's not worth the money. Download the demo if you want, but do not pick this game up. The controls are awful. It should be played like Shadow Complex, but the problem is the controls are so horrible. The game is it's annoying, and the problem is, of course, the shooting mechanism is not automatic. You have to trigger everything, and the trigger is just it's wrong. They placed everything wrong. It's the worst nightmare of controls in a long time. So definitely stay away for that. games and demos that came out for the PSP on the PSN store: Pinball Heroes and Bundle, Bomberman Land, and Dungeon Explorer. Of course, add-ons and expansions, some new Pain stuff, Dragon Ball, Raging Blast, Android Pack, and it's actually free, this one. Some DLC Midnight Show for the Saboteur, which they already announced a couple of weeks ago, or I think it actually was before the game came out that they said that the DLC will, they're going to release DLC, but this, but the problem is they probably had other plans, but, well, the company that made the game went bankrupt, so you're probably not going to see more DLC than the DLC that they've been talked about before that. A lot of the Zendaya 2 Dark Hero Days DLC 1 to 7. It's about $2 each. Some of them are free. A lot of Rock Band stuff. And a lot of game videos. And since it's the start of the new year, the new version of Core came out, episode 20. And of course, the... the other one, which is Pulse, came out of also. I recommend that Pulse is free, so I recommend you at least watch that if you want some updates on stuff that's, or some insight on some of the stuff that's coming out soon or is already out. But Core was actually really, really good today, or this episode was really good, but. Sadly, you have to pay free bucks if you want the only this episode, or you can do a subscription. I think it's $15 a year. I can't remember. Anyways, I have a subscription, and I downloaded this one, and you got insight on Bayonetta, Dante's Inferno, which is coming out next month, January 9th. For PS3 and Xbox 360. I already talked about it a couple episodes before. They're really pushing the game. They made some interesting new interviews with some of the people. They told a little bit deeper story of it. I don't think I'm going to talk too much about it because of I already covered a lot of it last couple of episodes. But if you want to check it out, download Core, or you can listen to some of the later episodes. Bayonetta, they covered the PS3's version, of course, because that's the only one version they're going to cover because it's a PSN show. They haven't talked about, of course, the problems with it, which is rumored still. I can't confirm it. I didn't really see the big difference between the Xbox 360 and the PS3 version when I looked at the demo. It seems to run okay. I've seen the game trailers, comparisons of the thing, and when game trailers does that, I think it's mostly because they just wanna fuel the the fanboy war between the two consoles. I don't understand why people do that. It's stupid. Pick up the version that you like for the console that you like. Of course, if the game is totally broken, which had happened, for instance, for. I know Grand Theft Auto 4 had some you couldn't save when that came out, and I know some of the add-ons for 360 Fallout 3 deleted your save games and actually crashed the game and stuff like that. But this I haven't heard of it. I think there's some tearing issues, graphic tearing, and the game and stuff like that on the PS3 version. But it's I heard it should be actually okay compared to all the things that Sega announced or was leaked about, that the game was horrible and horribly ported and Sega wasn't really proud of it. But anyways, I'm looking a little bit forward to it. It got a 90 on Metacritic, great reviews, selling great. Some of the my friends already picked it up and is playing it, and they like it. None of them actually have picked up Darksiders, even though I have tried to tell people this game is going to be great. And it is. It's probably the best hack and slash adventure game that I've played so far. I think it's better than God of War. It's something that, if I compare it, for instance, to what people are, what the developer was saying, it's taking a little bit of God of War and a lot of Zelda. I think what this game is, that is it. If I compare it to these two things, they are saying Zelda, I think it has the same style of gameplay dungeon-wise. It is not the game as Zelda. They are two different games totally, but there are some similarities. And to my liking, because it's more modern gaming, the way they have done it, it's really good. And I like it a lot. I've been having a blast. I've played at least 7 or 8 hours of it straight. So it's really addictive. And the story is great. The voice acting, it's great. Mark Hamill is one of the character voice actor in the game. Let me tell you a little bit about the story from the game's point of view. In the beginning, heaven and hell were battling, and there was a council of maintaining the balance. They had the enforcers, which were the four horsemen. At a point, heaven and hell tried to seize their war a bit, and in those years, suddenly man came popping up in this thing, in this whole dilemma. And the council foretells these weak but cunning creatures will be implemented into the balance, and so the third kingdom was established, the kingdom of man. Through this, finally a cease was made, a pact which was implemented by seven seals. And when these seven seals was broken, the four horsemen will ride and punish the wicked, and either be man, demon, or angel. So that's pretty much what the whole inline starts with. And what happens here is that you start out as War, which is your character. You play War, one of the four horsemen of the apocalypse. You dive down to a middle of a city on Earth, fully immersed in battle with angels and demons, and you do your job. The problem is something goes wrong. You go through the city a bit, and through that you see one of the higher rankings angels fight one of the higher ranking demons. The problem is that you can't find any of your brothers, your other three companions of the four brotherhood of the four horsemen. And the problem is that it looks like the apocalypse never came. The seven seals were not broken. So through that, the council takes your power. You accidentally, through those powers, you lose. You lose a battle to one of the bigger demons. You try to fight off, and you get summoned by the council after that for an explanation. And you did aid the demons in winning the battle, and the Kingdom of Man is pretty much at the end at this point. And this is where the game starts, where you get stripped from your power, you're punished, and you get a chance to find out what happened, and they send you back powerless, or not powerless. You get at least your some weapons and and some aid to guide you and figure out what happened. You've been getting sent back to Earth, and I think it's a decade after all the first part of the game happened, or pretty much the intro of the game. And that's pretty much it. The style of the gameplay is, like I said, is Zelda hack and slash God of War like, but more simple. God of War has the medium, the normal, and heavy attack, which where this game actually doesn't have a heavy attack. It just has an attack button, which is for the PS3, the square. I would think it would be the blue X, is it X? Yeah, it's X for the Xbox 360 probably. Anyways, square for the PS3, you jump on X for the PlayStation, and probably A on the 360. But anyways, and you have and you can grab objects and throw them. So you grab an object with circle, and you throw with the right trigger. You can target enemies with the left trigger, and switch between targets with the right analog stick, and of course you move with the left analog stick. The right bumper lets you block or do a quick dash in the direction you choose to go in, which is pretty neat. And it's a dash, it's a power dash of some kind. It's hard to say, because you can actually keep on dashing constantly around the enemies in circle wise if you know the way to do it, and it's pretty effective. And it's pretty neat, and you can actually, just like in Zelda, you can pretty much, like, some of the people to try to play Zelda try and speedrun it, they tumble a lot to because it's faster, and I think the dash is actually faster in a game than normal running. Anyways, the left trigger is your items and magic. You hold it in, and square, triangle, circle, and X become the menus. You can choose. You have four slots for each button, where you can put in a ability or a magic ability or item you want to use or something like that. The D-pad is where you select your weapons. Your other equipped items. When you don't have something to throw, the right trigger will be your secondary weapon. For instance, like the boomerang in Zelda, where this here, where you get a shuriken, a big, large one, as a batarang, like, or a boomerang, like that. You also get a gun later in the game, and you what else is there? You get a horn to call ancient creatures forth. So you can switch around with the D-pad. What things you would have, for instance, in your secondary hand, and you actually, the triangle when you fight is actually not used, but you can buy a scythe, so you can actually do, like, I don't think it's a heavy attack. It's actually a secondary weapon. So the square will be your main sword, which is the Chaos Eater. The triangle will, for instance, be your your glove, you get a power glove of some kind where you can break ice with. And that's the triangle. So and you can use those two weapons in a combination with the square and the triangle. But if you just want to use the only that weapon, you just keep on pushing triangle and doing stuff with your character. For instance, you have to, for instance, if you do a uppercut slash, you push down and hit the square. If you have that ability by that combo. Or you can just hold the triangle in and you power up your glove and then smash it into the ground and you will send everybody with an earthquake style up in the air around you and 5 feet from you. So that's how the game works. You can which is a really, really neat feature also, you can zoom in over your shoulder. And this is where, if you shoot or throw your shuriken, you can get a targeting scope where you can move around, and you can actually log on to stuff like Zelda, where you, for instance, mark three things, and then you throw your boomerang or your whatever it's called, and it goes and hits those three targets. So, really, really neat feature into that, and of course, a lot like Zelda. The game is fantastic voiced over. You, the council banishes you, and actually, before it sends you back to Earth, it puts a watcher on you, which is Mark Hamill's voiced, and he does a great job. And you can, he's a little bit like the fairy. Link has, you can summon him up for advice, for funny remarks. He's just a bit more evil, and he follows you through the whole game because he's bound to you. So he's pretty much your sidekick. I will try to find a list of some of the voice actors that are in the game. There's not all of them, and I will also post, I found a YouTube link to the intro if you want to see it and might convince yourself that it is Jeremy Irons, but nobody can figure it out because he at least hasn't come out and said anything in an interview or anything. Well, that's pretty much Darksiders. It's got 78 score on Metacritic, I think. Really great score. I was hoping for more. As I said, Bayonetta gotten a 90. I was hoping it would be the other way around, but because I definitely think Darksiders is more entertaining in the long run than Bayonetta, but I can't really say it 100% because I haven't played Bayonetta yet, but from the demo and from what I played of Darksiders, definitely like Darksiders more. So pick that up if you want to. I don't know if there's a collector's edition of this game here, because I can see on Joystick, for instance, that they probably, I think it's probably a review stuff they got from the developer, but they got a Darksiders war figure, a t-shirt, a book, and the game, and I think a booklet of some kind. I'm not sure here. Let's see, a t-shirt, good, Darksiders, blah, blah. Chaos Eater. Let's see. At the time we randomly select one. Oh, you can win actually this one here. I will post a link to this, but sadly it's not buyable. I would really love the war and the t-shirt, which is pretty cool. Check that out. what else can we talk about? I forgot that Mark Hamill actually, I think he got interviewed by PC News, and Kotaku actually gave put up some story about it also, because they probably seen the interview on PC News. But anyways, we all know Mark Hamill has done a lot of voice acting after the Star Wars thing, and the one thing that I noticed where I really annoyed that Kotaku don't look up their thing, and this here was posted by Brian Ashcraft, and they say that Mark Hamill's last voice acting was the Batman Arkham Asylum, which he also did. He did the Joker in that. The problem is that I think there was another interview, and this was done by Game Trailers just at around, I think it was just after, oh, it was at the awards, the Spike TV Awards, Game Awards, where Mark Hamill was actually on the red carpet, and they interviewed him, and he said that he actually was out here to promote Darksiders. And I'm pretty sure that Kotaku was there, and they probably noticed it, so I don't understand why Brian Ashcraft goes ahead and says something, or writes something so stupid without actually checking up that he's actually promoting Darksiders right now. And it is the latest of his voice acting. So again, a sad story for that. Really see a lot of things on Kotaku where they don't check up on stuff, and it's getting annoying in my opinion. I hope they do better in this year than they done the last year. I just ordered some more games. BioShock 2 is coming out soon. Coming out, when is it? Next month, I think. Which I'm really interested in. I actually got last week BioShock 1 on PS3. I actually have played it and I've beaten it on the PC, but I want it on the PS3. I played a little bit of it, but since I got Darksiders, I laid it down and trying to finish Darksiders and Bayonetta, and hopefully the BioShock to refresh the story and get ready for BioShock 2. And of course I ordered what else did I order? I ordered Dante's Inferno Collector's Edition for PS3 and a Heavy Rain. And Heavy Rain was also represented in the Core Edition, and the Core Edition, where Heavy Rain is, they talked a little bit about the story of the game. And the story is that there's a killer on the loose, and in the game you play four persons, where you switch between. The first person you're gonna play is a dad, where his son gets kidnapped, and he breaks down, his family goes on, and he tries to find his kid. Then you play a PI, a private investigator, and you play a FBI agent, and you play, of course, the girl that most of you have seen in the trailers, which is a news reporter, and all people are looking for this killer. And the interesting thing about this game here is that you play through different scenarios, and some of their storylines cross each other, but it depends on the path you choose. And through this deeper insight of Core, I finally figured out what actually the hood is and how the game is played. So it's pretty much a movie based. It's not that you move around probably with the analog stick and all that, but not that much. Actually, a cinematic experience, more like, from the feel I get it. And through that, for instance, you see for instance, a scene where you get caught by a villain, and he wants to bring you, get you on your knees, and he tells you to go forth. And through that, you see the hood come up. That you see, you go past, for instance, a board with wheels, and if you push the button, the blue cross button, the jump button, or not the jump button, but the X button. That's the word I was looking for. The X button. You take that and you shove it back, and he falls for it. And then, for instance, to grab his gun, you before you do that, and all the things is that it will be small pop-out boxes with a line to the to the thing that you're gonna do or grab, where you activate them. So it's gonna be like action sequenced in some parts. And the funny thing is, and this was actually a really surprise, if one of the characters that you play dies, for instance, if you do something and he dies, the game is not over. Just this character's story doesn't progress on, and you might go forth to the next character and through the story and the whole intervene. So it's going to be a different experience for each person, depending on the choices you make and the things that you do. And yeah, you actually get to play a little bit in the cinematic experience, where you choose what to do. And I tried different things, and each time a different outcome. And you can, of course, die. And you can, of course, live. And you can, of course, live. And in this, in those living moments, you do different things, for instance. You can choose to arrest somebody, and if you, and somebody else, you choose to shoot them. So it's pretty much a really, really entertaining experience. I think definitely different experience from what I've seen at how a thriller based game could be. So I finally got myself to pick it up, and it's coming out next week, so I'm looking forward to that. That's pretty much it for what's coming up the next month. There's been, of course, talk. There's been the there's been a press conference by Sony. There's been a press conference by Xbox. Microsoft press conference. Sony didn't introduce much, in my opinion. I saw some of the keynotes. They talked about they want to, instead of the PSN network, they want to let it grow. They introduced, of course, the 3D thing, that all their Bravia TVs will support 3D, and the PlayStation 3 will get a firmware update, so it can you can play games on 3D. But they're gonna do a whole 3D library. 3D movies are gonna be able to be downloaded from the PSN store. But the big thing is they're gonna push the free PSN network to other devices, probably PC, maybe mobile phones. They didn't talk about that, but they want to expand it. They want to make their main thing, just like Xbox Live is for Microsoft for gaming, but they want to do more of it. And of course they're going to expand movies, and hopefully they're going to expand their region. It's already in Europe, but the problem is not in all countries yet, and they said they're going to expand this for through the year. Xbox, well, they talked about Natal, of course. They're saying it's coming this holiday, and it's going to be a whole different experience with that. I'm still skeptical about it. I'm not there yet to put down a controller and just wave around my hands and play games. It's just, in my opinion, it's stupid. And they talked about what their plans are for the next thing, and all the support the Xbox Live, the whole platform is. And they're saying that you should be able to, or he at least said it. I don't know if he meant it, if it's going to happen, but if you buy an Xbox game, game on demand through Xbox Live, you should actually be able to play it both on your Xbox or your PC. And I'm interested in seeing how that's going to work. It all sounds like they're going to... Both of the companies are going to try and integrate their... Or expand their market more. Well, Nintendo, of course, has mentioned that Miyamoto wants motion control in the DS. And I can't see anything interesting doing with a motion control for a handheld. A handheld is a device where you just have... Well, some people have more, but for instance, if you travel or commute from home to work and from work to home each day, you probably maybe sit in a train or something for a half hour, maybe an hour or more. And that's where the handhelds come in, or if you travel with plane or something. That's where I use them. Of course, I play them at home when I feel like it. But... Those are the main reasons, and I can see motion control work other than the DS already does a bit of motion control where you have to blow in your microphone or whistle or something where it recognizes your effects through a peripheral to the game. And of course the stylus and the DS, but I don't see you waggling around or doing stuff and with this. Nobody's gonna do that in a public place. It's different doing this in your home with the Wii, but nah, I don't think it's gonna work. I think they are shooting way, way, way from their audience, in my opinion. At least for normal gamers that I know and hardcore gamers, this is lame. And people are saying that Sony has a lot of PSP versions out there, but just think, if they introduce a DSi with peripherals in it, that's going to be... The third DSi that's come out, at least in 2 years, and they're probably going to do a DSi and a DSi XL, which just came out, just came out in the US, not out here in Europe yet, if I remember correctly. So it's really I'm really skeptical about that, doing peripherals and all that stuff on a handheld. I don't think it's a good idea. I was still hoping for when the PSP Go was rumored, it had the second analog stick, but it sadly didn't. Things are still the same with the handhelds. Stylus, touchscreen, or normal controls. And I think it works, and I think it's what people want, mostly. Of course, the iPhone, people are going nuts about that, but I still don't think the touchscreen stuff, what iPhone does, is precise enough to actually work on hardcore, normal games like Zelda, a Resistance Retribution game, a Ratchet and Clank and stuff like that. I still think buttons is the right way to go on those games. We'll have to check it out. The new thing for phone gaming, or just if you talk a little bit, go a little bit off talking instead of light story games, but let's talk technical stuff a little bit. The Nexus One, which I ordered one of those, came out, and it has a 1 gigahertz processor in it, which is twice as much as normal Android phone has, and it's more powerful than the iPhone at the moment, iPhone GS. It's interesting to see if they're gonna do games for that. It doesn't support multi-touch in the US, but rumors is that the screen, of course, supports multi-touch, but because of rights and afraid of getting sued, they locked it up in their system, so you can unlock it for third party stuff, and probably unlock it if you know how to do it. But that's an interesting thing, and phones are becoming more and more advanced. The iPhone was the first step. Android is doing a lot of things right now. HTC is coming up with great phones, and it is the Google phone, the Nexus One, is an HTC made phone, but not sold by HTC. It's sold by Google, and its software support is going to be Google themselves. I can say I already have the HTC Magic, and I've and one of my colleagues has the HTC Hero, and right now I know there are emulators and stuff out there, so you can play games, and there are also marketplace where you can download games. So it is coming with small steps. I don't know if the Android market is going to be just as big as the iPhone market with games, but I think it's going to come in the end if people want it. The Android is open source, so it's hard to say make games or do stuff without having to actually do it, maybe do it for free, because 99.9% of all things are free on the Android compared to, well, the iPhone. Well, probably have to pay a buck or so for some things, but well, that's how things go. But that's pretty much it for me this week. If you want to contact me, as usual, email me. You can follow me on Twitter. And of course, you probably, if you follow me on Twitter right now, at some point you're going to know when I'm finished with my games. I always put a Twitter up when I'm finished with a game. You can, of course, PM me on the Speed Gamers forum, where I'm at pretty much every day. And of course, when the Speed Gamers hold the marathon, which the next marathon is, of course, going to be the Metroid Marathon, in March, you can probably see me there in the chat. So that's pretty much it for this time. Thank you for listening, and I'll see you around. Bye.